إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، فأن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, verily the most truthful speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is that of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of affairs are the ones that we introduce into this deen of ours, because every newly introduced matter is an innovation, and every innovation will lead astray, and whatever is astray will be going to the hellfire. The Islamic Sharia, or law, legislation, is characterized by three distinct qualities that no other Sharia that preceded us shared this particular, these three qualities with our Sharia. No Sharia. And of course, there's nothing coming afterwards. Three distinct qualities that are only found in the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah. First, al-baqa, permanence or continuity. Doesn't stop, it's permanent. Allah says in the Quran, ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was not the father of any one of your men, but he was the messenger of Allah and the seal, the last of all prophets. And if he's the last of all prophets, and Allah said, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Do you assume we created you in vain, and to us you will not return? If we didn't have a law to live by, then it will be in vain. So then his message is the permanent message, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In a hadith of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu in Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ وَإِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمٌ وَاللَّهُ يُعْطِي وَلَنْ تَزَالُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ قَائِمَةٌ عَلَى أَمْرِ اللَّهِ لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ مَنْ خَالَفَهُمْ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. It's in Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whosoever Allah intends goodness for, he will grant him understanding of the deen. And verily, I am the one who distributes, but it is Allah who gives. Not as many people claim, that it's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who gives. إِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمٌ وَاللَّهُ يُعْطِي. It's Allah Azza wa Jalla who gives and grants and bestows. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would divide that among the Muslims. Then he said, and verily they shall remain, this ummah will remain, this ummah will remain upon the command of Allah. They will not be harmed by those who oppose them until Allah's command comes, which is Al-Qiyamah. So in this hadith, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this ummah will remain until the end of time. No one will be able to harm them. You know, all the war against Islam, burning the Quran, drawing cartoons of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, killing the Muslims all over the world. This is what we see today. This is what we're living today. With all these efforts, and double and triple, they will not be able to eliminate Islam. They will not be able to get rid of us. We will remain like a fork in their throats until the Yawm al-Qiyamah. And then the tables will be turned around and they will be in the lower position and the Muslims will be in the upper position. When we do some things though. And the lecture tonight, inshallah, will be addressing some of the things we need to do so we may get there. The second characteristic or quality of that is distinct to this ummah is al-umum, encompassment, generality. It encompasses everyone during all times. Every human being and jinn is expected to hear, once they hear about Islam and the message of Allah and the message of the Prophet ﷺ from Allah, they are expected to embrace this religion. They don't have a choice. We have many evidences for that. And once the Prophet ﷺ, once his message is encompassing, that means that everyone out there is part of the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, as in those who are supposed to adhere. However, that ummah is of, as the scholars categorize it, is two. Ummah al-da'wah wa ummah al-ijabah. The ummah of propagation, the ummah whom you're supposed to invite to Islam, and the ummah who will embrace Islam, which is us. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ دَارِ السَّلَامِ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah invites everyone to the abode of peace, to paradise. This is Ummatul Da'wah. Allah did not mention the maf'ul bihi. The object of the sentence is emitted. Allah invites to Darus Salam. He didn't say who. That means everyone who listens is invited. Then Allah said, and He guides whosoever He wills to the straight path. This is the Ummah of Ijabah. Those who will respond to the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and will be among the Muslims. Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. Say, O mankind, verily I am the Messenger of Allah unto all of you, to all the people. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. You were only sent as mercy to everyone, human and jinn. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, in reinforcing this idea, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَا يَسْمَعُ بِي أَحَدٍ من هذه الأمة يهودي ولا نصراني ثم يموت ولم يؤمن بالذي أرسلت به إلا كان من أصحاب النار رواه مسلم. He swore صلى الله عليه وسلم by the one who the soul of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is in his hand. This is Allah عز وجل. No one hears about me from this ummah. Ummah of what? إجابة or دعوة? The ummah of دعوة. Jew or Christian, then he dies without accepting what I was sent with, except that he will be among the inhabitants of the hellfire. Anyone who hears the da'wah of Islam and he doesn't accept it will be among the inhabitants of the hellfire. Again, this is the encompassment of the sharia of Islam. Now, Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, was he sent to everyone? No. He was sent to the Jews. I was only sent to the lost sheep of the children of Israel. He said that as biblically quoted. Every prophet was sent to his qawm, but the Prophet ﷺ was sent to everyone. This is a quality of Islam no one shares. Last but not least, and this is where we will be stressing the discussion this evening. Kamal, perfection, flawlessness, immaculateness. This deen is perfect. And as simple and basic as this sounds, as complicated as it is to the people of desires and whims. I mean, the issue requires no thinking. Even in the English language or whatever other language you speak, look it up in your dictionary. What does the word perfect mean? What does it mean? Perfect! Right? I mean, what else are you going to say? If there was a cup of water here and you filled it up to the top, and we will call this perfection, then adding anything or deleting anything negates perfection. There's only one stage where it could be perfect. Right at the rim of that cup. At the rim of that cup, if the water is leveled, this is perfection. Anything else, add, delete. If you add more, it will spill. If you take out some, it will be incomplete. Perfect. Do we have an evidence for that? Yes, we do. Do we have an evidence? We have evidences. But where are the people who understand? Let me just give you the most basic one that cannot be debated by anyone or disputed. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. Now this ayah was revealed in Hajj on the day of Arafah while the Prophet ﷺ was in Arafat. This ayah was revealed. This day, I have perfected your religion for you. And I have completed my favor upon you. and I am pleased with Islam as a way of life for you. Now Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah is saying, this day I have perfected your religion. What does that mean? Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum. This day I have perfected for you your religion. Can you add or delete anything? Can you? After Allah said that He completed the religion, He perfected the religion? No, you can't. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, taraktukum ala mithli al-bayda laylaha kanahariha la yazighu anha illa halik. I have left you upon a clear plain. Its night is like its day. You don't get confused. The deen is so clear. The night like the day, there's no distinction. So clear, clear plain. None deviates from it except one who is destroyed. Once you go off a little bit, to the right or to the left, you're destroyed. Why? Because the religion has been explained, explicitly perfected. There's nothing that anyone can do after the death of the Prophet ﷺ that is outside the boundaries of the Sharia. That is outside the boundaries of ijtihad and qiyas, which are part of the deen. No one can do anything. This is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. This is in Ibn Abi al-Asim, fi sunnah. It's an authentic narration. As you know from previous experiences, we never, never, ever, inshallah, quote a weak narration. Unless a mistake is made. Otherwise, every hadith is revised and authenticated before it is quoted to you for your benefit. Now Allah says in the Quran, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And we have sent down upon you the book as clarification for everything. Listen to the words, focus, analyze. We have sent down to you the book as clarification for everything. Now some of the funny people, right, the Quranites, say, okay, this is an evidence that you don't need the Sunnah. Because Allah said in the Quran, that He made the Quran, in this Quran everything has been clarified. Now these people who fail to read the Quran correctly, or they only read whatever suits their desires, in the same surah, this is the Surah An-Nahl, a few verses away, a few ayat away, Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. And we have sent down the book upon you, so you may clarify for the people what was sent down upon them. Who will do the clarification? The Prophet ﷺ. If the Quran was clear without the explanation of the Prophet ﷺ, this ayah will have no meaning. It will have no meaning. We send down the dhikr upon you, so you may clarify to the people. How is that? Allah says in the Quran, وَمَن يُطِعِ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whosoever obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah. When you obey the Prophet ﷺ, you have obeyed Allah. So the Quran and the Sunnah, according to the understanding of the Sahaba and those who came after them, is the actual means, is the only way you will get the right understanding of Islam. This is what Allah said in the Quran concerning the perfection of Islam. Allah says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ. Whatever the messenger gives you, take it. Whatever he forbids you from, then leave it alone and have taqwa of Allah. How can you apply this ayah if there was no sunnah? Then the Quran would be, there will be no involvement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He alayhi salatu wasalam taught us everything that we need to know concerning the deen. And we will see why I'm focusing on the deen, because some people have a misunderstanding. He, Salman al-Farisi, some of the kuffar said to him, your messenger taught you everything, even defecation? He said, yes. He told us not to face the Qibla while defecating or urinating, not to use our right hands, not to clean ourselves with less than 3 stones, that's what they used back then, and not to use bones. Even the means, the manner of relieving oneself, as in this area, it's part of the deen, because this is part of the deen. How many, you know, not using your right hand, is it from the matters of the dunya or the deen? It's from the matters of the deen. Even that, the non-Muslims were shocked. Your messenger taught you everything, even, you know, bathroom business. He said, ajal, yes. And he explained the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ concerning relieving oneself. He said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, مَا تَرَكْتُ شَيْئًا يُقَرِّبُكُمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ. I have not left out anything which will get you closer to Allah except that I commanded you to do it. Now this is a very important hadith. Remember it. I have not left anything which will get you closer to Allah except that I commanded you to do it. Nothing which will get you closer to Allah except that we have from the sunnah, whether it is a statement of the Prophet ﷺ, or it is an acknowledgement or approval of his, or it is his actions. Anything that will get you closer to Allah, he said, nothing was left out except that I commanded you to do it. We will see why this hadith is important in a little bit. So the question is, if this is the case, then where did these innovations come from? Then why do we have innovations? Why do Muslims insist on introducing into this deen that which is not part of it? Even though the Prophet ﷺ made this explicit explanation. So we call this lecture the extermination of innovation. Because innovations need to be exterminated. They need to be kicked out and eliminated from the teachings of Islam, so we may go back to what the Sahaba and the righteous predecessors used to be upon. Now, before I give you the definition of innovations, it is good for you and I to know the following. Innovations are more beloved to Iblis and his children, the shayateen, than sins. Our last lecture was what? Reasons for destruction. And we said that the sins are the primary reason behind the destruction of individuals and nations and so on and so forth. With that, with the evil of sins and the consequences, bid'ah, innovation is more pleasing, more beloved, and more favorable to shaitan than the sins. You may say, how? Why? Well, I'll give you some evidences. First, Sufyan al-Thawri said, al-bid'atu ahabbu ila iblis min al-ma'asiyah. لِأَنَّ الْبِدْعَ لَا يُتَابُ مِنْهَا وَالْمَعْصِيَةُ يُتَابُ مِنْهَا. He said, bid'ah is more beloved to Iblis than sin. Why? Because you will repent from sin. When you do a sin, you know inside you did something wrong. And you have means to get forgiven by Allah. But when you deal with a mubtadi', he doesn't see it as wrong. The sinful person recognizes the error within them. The innovator, hardly ever. So this is why he doesn't repent from it. You can tell the mubtadi' for years, this is a bid'ah, this is, and he will not leave it alone. And you probably know people who you've been telling this all their lives and all your lives, and they will not leave it alone. And guess what? Many of them, they will continue to live in this way and die upon this bid'ah. They will not leave it alone. This is a fact. No one can deny. I have my own personal experiences from my own people in my local masjid. People who we told many times, ya akhi, don't do this. And they continue to do it over and over again, even though they have no textual evidence to support this action of theirs. That's my experience. Maybe you can share yours, and maybe you've had your own as well. So this is why. Now, another reason why, we have the hadith of Jabir in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Inna Iblis yada'u arshahu 'ala al-ma." Iblis, he places his throne over the water. And then he brings all of his children, the shayateen, the devils, who line up. And each one of them gives him a report. They report to him what evil they did. So one of them will come and say, I stayed, you know, whispering to him until he drank alcohol. He will say, get out of here, you didn't do anything. This is a hadith sahih. Go away from here, you didn't do anything. The other one will come, I remained with him until, you know, until he ate pig. He would say, get out of here, you didn't do anything. I remain with him, behind him until, you know, he looked at a woman. Get out of here. They will continue to report. He will say, you haven't done anything. And then finally, one of them comes. He said, I remained whispering to him and harassing him until he divorced her. He will say, anta, 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 you, 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 and he will embrace him. Now, what does the hadith tell you? That all these sins that the shayateen were actually making the children of Adam commit to shaitan, he's not really worried about it. You know why? Because if you were to have breakfast, and after you say breakfast, after you breakfast, say Alhamdulillah الذي أطعمني هذا ورزقنيه من غير حول مني ولا قوة غفر لك ما تقدم من ذنبك. Allah will forgive all of your previous sins. So all the effort that the shayateen are doing is gone to waste with you repenting to Allah. If you make a dhikr, we have how many things? Hajj mabrur will get your sins forgiven. We can enumerate maybe 500 things in Islam that the Prophet ﷺ promised, if you do them, all of your sins will be forgiven. Right or wrong? So the shaitan, you know, he works and works and works, and someone will disobey Allah for 30 years, just a month before they die, they repent to Allah, and all these sins are gone. And all the efforts of the shayateen is wasted. So he doesn't really care. But a bid'ah, that's not the case. Then that person will have a whole other set of rulings which we will discuss later. And you all know the hadith of the man who killed 99 people. That's the biggest example of how Allah Azza wa Jal can forgive someone even if they killed 100 souls. But the mubtadi' will not repent. Now, let's see on the other hand, how the Prophet ﷺ dealt with the mubtadi'ah. You all know Dhul Khuwaisira. When the Prophet ﷺ was distributing some of the war booties among the Sahaba, and this man called Dhul Khuwaisira said, Ya Muhammad, i'dil. He said, Oh Muhammad, be just. He said, Woe to you. If I am not just, if I don't apply justice, then who does? If the Messenger of Allah is not just, who will do it? Umar said, Allow me, O Messenger of Allah, so I may strike his neck. He said, No, leave him. He's not alone. There are many who will come after him. If you were to compare your salah to the Sahaba, to theirs, and your fasting to theirs, you will find yourself as nothing. They will read the Quran, it will not go beyond their throats. Wallahi, if I were to be alive, لَأُقَتِّلَنَّهُمْ قَتْلَ عَاد. I will kill them the way Allah killed the people of Ad. You know who these are? Al-Khawarij, the first bid'ah. Now look at the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When it came to the sinful, when a man who used to drink alcohol often was brought to him, his name is Abdullah. They used to call him Himar. He used to make the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam laugh all the time. And one time he used to always be caught drinking alcohol. They would bring him in and, you know, establish the had ta'zir. They would lash him and hit him and whatever. So one time while they were hitting him, one of them said, Allahumma al'anhu. Oh Allah, curse him. He said, don't say that. In one narration, don't help the shaitan over your brother. And the other narration said, don't say that. Verily, the only thing I know of him is loving Allah and his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this is a sinful man who was drinking alcohol, but because he loved Allah and his messenger, he didn't have a bid'ah. The Prophet ﷺ said, leave him alone. But the people of bid'ah, who their salah will be better than the sahaba, and their ibadah will be better than the sahaba, said, if I were alive, I will kill them like the people of Ad. Why? Because of bid'ah. You understand this bid'ah which people take lightly is not a joke. It's not a joke. And this was the attitude of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam concerning Ahlul Bid'ah. And the first bid'ah is the bid'ah of the Khawarij, who did what eventually? They went against the Muslims, declared the Sahaba as kuffar, and they killed them. The Khawarij. We still have them today. They remain as among the Ahlul Bid'ah up until today. But what did you get the point? The people of sin, there's room. The ma'siyah you can, but the people of bid'ah, even though they were better worshippers, you know, outwardly, inwardly, because of their bid'ah, because of their misunderstanding of the Quran and the Sunnah, they try to understand the ayat not according to the Sahaba. Look what happened of them. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them another hadith, kilabun nar, the dogs of the hellfire. Subhanallah al-Azim. Tayyib. Definition. You may be saying, okay, bid'ah, bid'ah, bid'ah. All day we hear bid'ah. Especially you Wahhabis, as they like to call us, even though Wahhab comes from Abdul Wahhab, and Wahhab is Allah the bestower. It's the name of Allah. So every time someone, as one of the ulama said, every time you hate hearing Wahhabi, you are hating one of the names of Allah. Be careful. Be careful. We're not. We're the people of the Sunnah. The people of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They always say, you know, everything is bid'ah, bid'ah, shirk, bid'ah, shirk, bid'ah. Yes, Habibi. If you continue to do shirk and bid'ah, I'm going to keep telling you shirk and bid'ah. What do you want? You want me to change the deen for you to be happy? It's wicked people. They insist on innovating. And when you present to them that this is an innovation, you say, everything is bid'ah for you. No, everything is bid'ah in the deen of Allah if you're going to bring something from outside. That's the reality. So what is a bid'ah? قال الطرطوشي أصل هذه الكلمة من الاختراع وهو الشيء يحدث من غير أصل سابق كقوله تعالى بديع السماوات والأرض. Linguistically, الطرطوشي said it is the origin of the word is inventing, invention. Like, you know, inventors who invented the light bulbs and electricity and, you know, whatever, the phone. What is his name? Bell? Hey. He said it is to bring something that had no pre-existing example or something similar to it, to do something that never existed before, to originate. And Allah says in the Quran, بَدِيعُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah is the originator of the heavens and the earth. Was there any other creator besides Allah who created the heavens and the earth that Allah copied that? حَاشَ لِلَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى. Who was the first to create heavens and earth? And the last? Allah Azza wa Jal. He is the badi'. Linguistically. Now, in the deen, however, we have another definition legally, as الشاطبي in الاعتصام and other scholars have said, هي طريقة مخترعة في الدين يقصد بها التعبد والتقرب إلى الله تبارك وتعالى. It is an invented way, invented method in the religion. Pay attention. We will see why. Because some people say, yeah, well, you know, you're wearing a watch. Did the Messenger of Allah wear a watch? Now, you got some city, wallahi, sometimes you think, no way someone will think like this among the Muslims. Why are you riding a car? Huh? Go buy a camel. Why don't you apply the sunnah? See, why? Why are you wearing this dope? What are these? Somebody, you know, left a comment in, I think, one of the lectures. What are these? This from the sunnah? Something along these lines. What is this? Okay, this is dunya. This is, you want to invent the dunya? Go ahead, Habibi. Make airplanes, helicopters, bring something new that flies. You know, no problem. Anything regarding the dunya is none of our business. We will deal with that, you know, in detail, inshallah, later on. But we're saying in the deen. It's an invented matter in the deen. And what is the intent of these people? To get closer to Allah. But is the niyyah alone sufficient? No. This is what we need to understand. The niyyah alone is not sufficient. How often do people have good niyyah with the wrong action? Good niyyah, wrong action, no deed. Bad niyyah, good action, no deed. Good niyyah, good action, deed. Good deed. The formula is clear. طيب. Some textual evidences that support this idea in Islam that we don't have anything, that Islam does not entertain innovations. First, you heard the introduction of the lecture. This was the way the Prophet ﷺ would introduce his Friday sermons and other occasions, and khutbat al-haja, even in marriage, marriage and engagements and whatever, he would say this introduction, which I said part of it, but the last part of it is, وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Woe to you from introducing anything into Islam, because every newly introduced matter is an innovation, every innovation will lead astray, and whatever is astray is going to the fire. Now, how often did the Prophet ﷺ say that? Very often. And he would be saying in that, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. Every. And كُلْ, linguistically, هُوَ لَفْظ عُمُوم وَشُمُول. One of the strongest words in indicating encompassment in the Arabic language is the kul, every. Kullu man alayha fan. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. Everyone upon earth shall perish. Every soul shall taste death. Kul means every. And the Prophet ﷺ said, every innovation will lead astray. Then we have some people come afterwards and say otherwise, but that will be coming later on. Hadith of Irbad ibn Sariya. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, I'm going to give you the English right away because of time. The Messenger of Allah admonished us. He gave us a maw'idah that was so effective, so heart, you know, it touched our hearts that our eyes shed tears and our hearts tremble. We said, O Messenger of Allah, it is as if you are giving us farewell. It seems like this is the reminder, the admonishment, the exhortation of someone who is bidding farewell. So give us advice. He said, I advise you to have taqwa of Allah and to listen and obey. to those who are in charge of you, even if it's an Abyssinian slave. And whosoever lives after shall see a lot of differences. وَمَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Whosoever lives after me, he shall see a lot of differences. What is the solution? What is the way out? فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ تَمَسَّكُوا بِهَا وَعَضُّوا بِهَا عَلَى النَّوَاذِجِ. Upon you is my sunnah. Not the sunnah of what's his name? Nizar or Sheikh Nazim. Not the sunnah of these weird individuals. The sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the four rightly guided khulafa: Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali radiallahu anhum wa ardahum. He said, hold on it tightly and bite on it with your molar teeth. Then he said, and woe to you from introducing anything into Islam, because every innovation will lead astray. This was among, this is when he had given him such an advice, such a reminder, that their hearts trembled and they started crying. And you know, when you are in this state, isn't that the best time for you to understand a reminder? When your heart is soft and you are down, isn't it the best time for you to actually be reminded and act upon the reminder and turn to Allah? Yes. When you're arrogant, you turn away. So at the most, you know, beneficial, appropriate time, he chose sallallahu alaihi wasallam to tell them about the things that will come after, the innovations in the deen, and what the solution is. But the people of innovation don't understand. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad. وفي رواية من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Hadith of Aisha and Bukhari and Muslim. Different narrations in Bukhari and Muslim with the same idea. Whosoever, the first one is, whoever introduces something into this deen of ours that is not part of it shall have it rejected. You bring anything new and you try to get closer to Allah with it, here the Prophet ﷺ promised that your deed will be rejected, Allah will not accept it. This is if you are the introducer, the inventor, the innovator. But let's say you're working or acting upon the bid'ah or the innovation of someone else. He said, "Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad." If you do any action that is not in according to this affair of ours, you will have it rejected. So whether you are bringing the bid'ah or you're acting upon a pre-existing bid'ah, either way your deed will be rejected. Allah will not accept it. Why? Because Allah knew how he should be worshipped, and he taught that to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who taught it to us and told us, there's nothing that will get you closer to Allah except that I told you about it. So once you try to add something else, then you don't believe in this hadith or in the ayah. It doesn't end. Listen to this hadith. This is an amazing hadith. Hadith of Ibn Mas'ud in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَا مِن نَبِيٍ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهُ فِي أُمَّةٍ قَبْلٍ إلا كان له من أمته حواريون وأصحاب يأخذون بسنته ويقتدون بأمره ثم إنها تخلف من بعدهم خلوف يقولون ما لا يفعلون ويفعلون ما لا يؤمرون فمن جاهدهم بيده فهو مؤمن ومن جاهدهم بلسانه فهو مؤمن ومن جاهدهم بقلبه فهو مؤمن وليس وراء ذلك من الإيمان حبة من خردل. Amazing hadith. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, there isn't a prophet whom Allah sent upon a nation, to a nation, except that among his people, they were disciples and companions. Hawariyun, disciples. Ashab, companions. أخذ يأخذون بسنتي. They take his sunnah. They apply his sunnah. And they follow his command. Now listen now. Then they would come after them other generations who say that which they do not do, and they do that which they're not commanded. They say that which they do not do, and they do things they were not commanded to do. Innovations. They bring things from their own mind. Now he said, whosoever struggles against him with his hand, he's a believer. Whosoever struggles against him with his tongue, he's a believer. Whosoever struggles against him with his heart, he's a believer. But after that last one, there isn't even a grain of mustard of iman. If you have no problem mixing with the people of innovation and you think life is good and dandy, then your iman is running on empty. Iman entails that you oppose it. You speak against it. You make it clear to the people that these are innovations. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make you and I among those who are acting upon this hadith. Among those who are doing jihad against the innovation and the innovators, because this is part of iman and our obligation in the deen. So are we among the hawariyun and the ashab, or these khalf who will say that which they do not do and do that which they are not commanded? Every Muslim is one of these two categories. Choose for yourself what will lead you to Jannah. Ibn Mas'ud narrated in the hadith in Ahmad, في مسنده رحمه الله تعالى خط لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خطا ثم قال هذا سبيل الله ثم خط خطوطا عن يمينه وشماله قال هذه سبل على رأس كل منها شيطان يدعو إليه ثم تلا قوله تعالى وأن هذا صراطي مستقيما فاتبعوه ولا تتبعوا السبل فتفرق بكم عن سبيله. Ibn Mas'ud said the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم drew a line for us on the ground in the dirt. And he said, this is the straight path of Allah. This is the path of Allah. Then he drew on the sides, right? SubhanAllah, amazing, amazing narrations. But people don't understand. He drew lines on the right and lines on the left. He said, these are other paths. On the head of each one is the shaitan calling you to himself or to this way. Then he recited the ayah in the Quran, and that Allah said, and this is my path. This is my straight path. So follow it. And do not follow other paths which will lead you, mislead you from the path of Allah. You see this beautiful hadith? He told him, this is the path of Allah. This is the sunnah. This is what I'm living. My way. And there are other ways. Shayateen are calling you to them. So every Sufi is a shaitan calling to Sufism. And every Ash'ari and every Mu'tazili and every Shi'i, all of these people are shayateen from the ins calling to their way. Wallahi al-azim. Wallahi. If they're ignorant, Allah will deal with them on the day of judgment. We judge by the outwardly and the apparent. These are, according to the nas of the Prophet ﷺ, shayateen calling you to them. The sunnah is one. The sunnah is one. The way is one. Anything other than that is a shaitan. And if you follow the shayateen, do you go to Jannah? Do you put your hand with the shaitan, hand in hand, and go to Jannah? La wallah. He's going to the Jahannam, and so will be his followers. Among the mushrikeen and the mubtadi'een. Illa ma sha Allah. Once three men from the Sahaba had good intentions. Good intentions. Went to Aisha radiallahu anha, said, tell us about the ibadah of the Messenger of Allah. How did he worship Allah? So she told them. So when they heard how devoted he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in worshipping Allah, they wanted to do something that will get him really closer to Allah. So one of them said, I will fast every day, I will never break my fast. The other one said, I will abandon marrying women, I will not marry women. And the last one said, I will pray all night and I will not sleep at all. Now is this good intention or not? Good niyyah. I mean, somebody's telling you, I don't want to sleep at night anymore, I want to worship Allah all night. The other one said, I'm not going to break my fast every day, saim, saim, saim. The other one is going to abandon marriage because, you know, he thought it would distract him. What happened? The news was given to the Messenger of Allah. Did he like it? No. He brought them, he said, did you say such and such and such? They said, yes. He said, well, I sleep at night and I pray. And I fast sometimes and I break my fast. And I marry women, and who's وَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Whosoever desires other than my sunnah, he's not of me. Now, these are sahaba, seeking nearness to Allah. This is very important because every mubtadi' will give you the same excuse. Akhi, dhikr is haram? Huh? Dhikr? You saying I cannot say dhikr? Quran, I cannot read Fatiha. What's wrong with Fatiha? The greatest chapter in the Quran. Ya Shaykh, Fatiha is a beautiful surah. But not when someone dies. Not in the beginning of the school day. Not, you know, one of these schools, you know, every morning, Fatiha, this was a new one, right? I thought it was only in the graveyard. And now, even in the school, they don't say anything else anymore. Fatiha, you know, they say Fatiha, then they end with Sadaqallahu al-Azim. Bid'ah upon bid'ah. Hey. But the niyyah then is not enough. The Prophet ﷺ did not like it. He said, if you desire other than my way, other than my sunnah, You're not of me. You want to go to extremes in worshiping Allah like the Sufis? You're not of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the narrations that will come after are even scarier. So then, if this is the case, how come some people insist, brother, there's bid'ah hasana and bid'ah sayyah? See, we don't understand. According to them, we are the feeble-minded. We are the ones who lack understanding of the deen after all these ayat and narrations. They say, you don't understand. There's good bid'ah and bad bid'ah. And I told you, remember from the lecture before, good bid'ah? Good bid'ah is equal to saying there's good shirk. Can someone tell you there's good shirk? It doesn't matter who he is. The biggest scholar of Islam, if he told you there's good shirk, you know, at times it's good to worship others with Allah. It's good, akhi. Not every shirk is bad. Say, brother, but this doesn't make any sense to me. I've always been taught that shirk is the biggest sin. It's in the Quran. So for someone to say there's good bid'ah, it is equivalent to them saying there's good shirk. If you reject the first, then you reject the second. But you know what? They have evidences. Evidences that they misunderstood. And we will enumerate them and refute them bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. So no one can give us this excuse ever after again. You understand this clearly. Because this is the thing you will deal with the most when you deal with Ahlul Bid'ah. Look, the hadith of Jarir ibn Abdullah in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man sanna fil Islami sunnatan hasana, falahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha ila yawm al-qiyamah. Wa man sanna fil Islami sunnatan sayyi'a, falahu fa'alayhi wizruha wa wizru man amila biha ila yawm al-qiyamah." Whosoever establishes a good, I'm going to say practice, a good sunnah in Islam, he will have the reward of that. And the reward of all those who follow him until the day of judgment, until the Yawm al-Qiyamah, the day of resurrection. And whosoever introduces a sunnah, a bad sunnah, we will see what the sunnah will mean, then upon him is its sin, and the sin of all those who follow him until the day of judgment. So they say, look brother, the hadith says, sunnah hasana, sunnah sayyah, good sunnah, bad sunnah. And they say, the hadith means, good bid'ah, and bad bid'ah. They explain the hadith as sunnah hasana, as bid'ah hasana. And sunnah sayyah, as bid'ah sayyah. Because if they don't do that, they don't have an evidence anymore. طيب. No problem. Do you know the context of the story? Does any one of you know the context of the story? Let me tell you the context. Once, some people from Mudar, some of the poorest among the Sahaba, came to the Messenger of Allah with their clothes worn out. They were no food. They were in horrible condition. When the Prophet ﷺ saw them, his face changed. He was sad at the condition of the Muslims, the way they looked. So he told Bilal to call the adhan. He led the people in salah. Then he gave a khutbah. He addressed the people, and he encouraged them to give sadaqah. And he quoted the ayat from the Quran that encouraged to give sadaqah. And then he said, give whatever you have. Part of the sa' of the barley, part of the sa' of the date, anything, even half a date, give sadaqah. But the Sahaba, they were a little reluctant. They still stayed in their place. Then one man went to his house and came back with a huge pile of food and clothes and whatever that he could hardly carry it. And he placed it in the middle. When the people saw him, what happened? They all got encouraged. So then everyone went home and started bringing stuff. Within a short time, there was a huge pile of clothes and food and everything. So the Prophet's face became, he got happy, he smiled, and he said this hadith. Whoever does a good practice, the man, what did he do? He was the first to initiate, is sadaqah bid'ah? Is giving sadaqah a bid'ah? So how do they apply this narration? It's a sunnah. It's a sunnah. If you initiate this practice and people follow you, you will have the good deeds. And if you do something evil which Allah had made haram, then you will get the evil deeds of the people who follow you. That's the first refutation. The context of the story is about sadaqah. And no one can say that sadaqah is bad or sadaqah is a bid'ah. Secondly, if we understand the hadith as the sunnah. He said, "Man sunna fil Islami sunnatan hasana." Here, does sunnah mean the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah? No. Because if you say that sunnah in this hadith means the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, then the hadith continues, "Waman sunna fil Islami sunnatan sayya." Do you have a bad sunnah? Do you have a bad sunnah? You don't have a bad sunnah, Shaykh. If you believe there's a bad sunnah for the Messenger of Allah, you need to reconsider your Islam. So the hadith, then the word sunnah, which means way, practice, cannot mean sunnah as they claim, which they turn into a bid'ah. Because if you were to do so, then sunnah hasana, sunnah sayyah means good sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, bad sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, a'udhu billah. There's no bad sunnah of the Messenger of Allah. That's the second point. The third point, the hadith says, "Man sanna fil Islam." Whoever initiates or revives a good practice in Islam, bid'ah is not in Islam. So the hadith doesn't apply. The hadith is speaking about in Islam, and anything that is bid'ah is not from Islam, because Allah says, "Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum." So Imam Malik said, now we have to understand the understanding of the tabi'een and the a'imma. He said, "Man ibtada'a fil Islam bid'atan hasana." Afwan, "Man ibtada'a fil Islam bid'atan fara'aha hasana, faqad za'ama anna Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wasallam khana ar-risala. Fa inna Allah yaqul al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati," until the end of the ayah. Who said, whosoever, look at Imam Malik, whosoever introduces into Islam an innovation and he sees it as something good, he has alleged, he has claimed that the Prophet ﷺ betrayed Islam, betrayed the message of Islam. Because Allah said, "This day I have perfected your religion for you." فَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دِينًا فَلَا يَكُونُ الْيَوْمَ دِينًا. Whatever was not part of the deen then, could not be part of the deen today. See how beautiful that is? When Allah revealed this ayah, Islam, let's say, was from A to Z. Islam was from A to Z when the ayah was revealed. Now whatever was not there cannot be of Islam today. You cannot add an extra letter. So you just add this in there. Look, when Allah revealed this ayah, we had A to Z. I'm sorry. Anything you add, you're claiming that the Messenger of Allah hid something. There was an extra letter in the alphabet which he did not teach us. And you, Mr. Intelligent, you were able to figure it out, mashallah, tabarakallah. You got to know what the Messenger of Allah did not know. You know how Allah wants to be worshipped better than the Messenger of Allah. He failed to tell us, but you figured it out. This is the condition of the innovator, even if he doesn't say that in your face. His condition is, the Messenger of Allah doesn't know how Allah should be worshipped. I know, I'll tell you. This is the innovators. And they will give you a new thing that the Messenger of Allah didn't teach. They're claiming that he betrayed the message of Islam. That's a very dangerous approach. That's a very dangerous position. Imam Shawkani said, what option do they have after Allah perfected the deen? Either they claim it's part of the deen. Okay. If they claim that this action, this belief of ours, this behavior, this act of worship is part of the deen, then they are denying the ayah and the Quran. And if they say, no, it's not part of the deen, then why are you wasting my time with something that is not part of the deen? That's what Imam Shawkani said. If it's part of the deen, you're denying the ayah. If it's not part of the deen, why are you wasting your time and my time with something that is not part of the deen? We only discuss matters of the deen. This was the understanding of the tabi'een and the righteous predecessors. طيب. The Prophet ﷺ said, we're still refuting this hadith, this misunderstanding of the hadith. كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالًا. Every innovation leads astray. If the hadith means, "Man sanna fil Islami sunnatan hasana," means, "Man ibtada'a fil Islami bid'atan hasana," that makes the hadith, "Kullu bid'atin dalala, kullu sunnatin dalala." You know, if A is equal to B, and B is equal to C, then A is equal to C. If they claim that the meaning of the hadith, "Man sanna fil Islami sunnatan hasana," it means, "Man ibtada'a fil Islami bid'atan hasana," then that makes the meaning of the hadith, "Kullu bid'atin dalala, kullu sunnatin dalala." Every sunnah will lead you astray. Is this possible? That's impossible. This hadith cannot be used with this foul understanding to support and propagate innovations. Furthermore, "Azidak min ash-shi'r qasida," I will increase you a poem,
The other narration in Sahih Ibn Majah explained this hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever revives a sunnah from my sunnah and the people act upon it, he will have the reward of it without his reward, will have the reward of those, all those who follow him, without his reward being diminished the least bit. Then look what he said. وَمَنْ ابْتَدَعَ بِدْعَةً فَعُمِلَ بِهَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ أَوْزَارُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا لَا يَنْقُصُ مِنْ أَوْزَارِ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا شَيْئًا. And whoever introduces an innovation which is acted upon, then he will gain the sin of all those who follow them without their sins being diminished the least bit. So the other hadith explicitly says, whoever revives, ahya sunnatan min sunnati, whoever revives a sunnah from my sunnah. But when it came to bid'ah, he said, man ibtada'a bid'atan, whoever introduces innovation, he didn't refer to himself, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because bid'ah never comes from the Messenger of Allah. So the other narrations further explain the correct understanding of this hadith at hand. The second misconception is the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu, ni'mati al-bid'atu hadihi. Ni'ma ends with the sukoon, man'an liltiqa' al-sakinayn, it becomes a kasra. Bid'ah has a dhamma at the end, because some people may think I'm saying it wrong. I'm trying to show them the grammar so they will know that this is the right way. What an excellent innovation this is. They say, Umar said, what an excellent innovation this is. That means that innovation is good and some of them are excellent. We say, time out. What is the context of this hadith, of this statement of Umar? Everyone knows. Taraweeh. In Bukhari, we learn that the Prophet ﷺ led the Sahaba in Taraweeh 3 nights. Then on the 4th night, he didn't come. He saw them later on. He said, I knew where you were. The only reason I did not show up is خَشِيتُ أَن تُفْرَضَ عَلَيْكُمْ, I was afraid it will become obligatory upon you, فَلَا تُطِيقُونَهَا, so, but you will not be able to carry it out. What prevented him from continuing? That Allah will reveal that this becomes a farida and Muslims will be negligent concerning Taraweeh, we will become sinful. So then he stopped, alayhi salatu salam. Now, after he died, Abu Bakr took the khilafah, which wasn't a long time, and still the Sahaba were praying Taraweeh. However, they would go to the masjid and pray in different groups. A man will have 4 people behind him, another will have 2 people behind him. They will pray in separate jama'at. Until Umar took the khilafah, radiallahu anhu wa arda. And then he realized that now that the Prophet ﷺ had passed away, could revelation come to change the ruling? So Taraweeh will remain sunnah ila yawm al-qiyam. So now this is a perfect time to revive the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, who led the Sahaba in one jama'ah. So he commanded Ubay ibn Ka'b to lead the people in salah under one imam. He being the imam, Ubay ibn Ka'b. And some of the people say, perhaps someone said to him, this is a bid'ah. He said, if you consider this a bid'ah, what an excellent bid'ah this is. This is the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, they claim this is a pathway to innovations. We say, assuming that Umar radiallahu anhu meant innovation in the deen, does anyone have the right to abandon the statement of the Messenger of Allah and accept the statement of anyone else? No. Even Abu Bakr, even Umar, even Uthman, even if all the Sahaba, which is impossible, were to say something, which never happened, in opposition to the Messenger of Allah, it is an obligation on every Muslim to follow who? The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it was narrated that Ibn Abbas said to the people, يُوشِكُ أَن تَنْزِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حِجَارَةً مِنَ السَّمَاءِ أَقُولُ لَكُمْ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَتَقُولُونَ قَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرٍ. He said, stones are about to be thrown at you from the skies. I say to you, the Messenger of Allah said, and you tell me Abu Bakr and Umar said. This is Ibn Abbas saying this to people during their time. He would tell them the hadith. They say, but Abu Bakr said. He said, Allah is about to send of you azab like Ashabul Fil. I tell you, the Messenger of Allah, you tell me Abu Bakr and Umar. Now we love and respect Abu Bakr and Umar with the ultimate way of respecting someone. But the hadith of the Messenger of Allah, his sunnah, cannot be negated by anyone else. So even if Umar meant that, it's an obligation to abandon the statement of Umar and refer to who? The Prophet ﷺ. What did he say? كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ dalala. Every innovation lead astray. And he didn't make a distinction of good innovation, bad innovation. That's the first refutation. Second, Umar was known of being among those who loved the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah. Can you imagine that he would mean this in a fiqh way? No. He must have meant the linguistic meaning of bid'ah. We already explained At-Tartushi said, is bid'ah what? It has a linguistic meaning or it doesn't? Allah is badi'u samawati wal ard. If these people want to be stuck on the legal meaning of the word and deny the linguistic meaning, then they're saying that the Allah Azza wa Jal is of the samawat al-ard. Hasha lillah. So we must make a distinction between the jurisprudential fiqh ruling and the linguistic ruling. Umar radiallahu anhu was referring to the linguistic idea, meaning if you consider this a bid'ah, what an excellent bid'ah this is, linguistically, not legally. Not legally. And let's just say to the people, look, ma fi mushkila. If you like the word bid'ah so much, if you're obsessed with the word bid'ah, and you revive the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah and call it bid'ah, ya akhi ruh. Umar, did he revive the sunnah? They called it bid'ah. We say to every mubtadi, you do the same. You look for sunan, which people abandon, revive them. If you call them bid'ah, that's half the problem. But you know what? They will not be reviving sunnah, they'll be bringing something new. Umar, radiallahu anhu, even when he said that, he didn't bring something new. He revived the sunnah. The mubtadi'ah, they don't revive the sunnah, they eliminate the sunnah and bring innovations up. And they differ on the meaning. No excuse for them. The third misconception, compiling the Quran. They say, you have books today, you have, Quran. Why? Why did you put the Quran in a mushaf? Huh? The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, didn't do it. Here you're doing bid'ah. Because this is part of the deen. Huh? It sounds funny, huh? No. Guess what? Hadith is in Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا تكتبوا عني ومن كتب عني غير القرآن فليمحه. Do not write down what I say. And whosoever writes down anything other than the Quran, then let him erase it. What does that mean? They were writing the Quran. You read in Bukhari. In Bukhari, read the chapter dealing with the compilation. And you will see in the clearest words, the Sahaba used to write down the Quran on leaves, on anything, rocks, anything that they were able to write on, they would write the Quran on these things. At the time of the Messenger of Allah, they used to write the Quran. Now he said, if I said something from my statement, erase it. Don't write it. But the Quran, keep it. So the Quran first was being written at the time of the Messenger of Allah. It's not an innovation. Writing it in a book is not an innovation. Second, it's a fulfillment of Allah's promise. Inna alayna jama'ahu wa Qur'ana. Upon us is collecting it and giving you the ability to recite it. Allah promised that this Quran will be collected. How could that be? It's in the book. Because when the people were, the Sahaba started dying in the battles, the Huffaz, the Qurra were dying, then it was necessary that it would be compiled in a book. And Allah called it what in the Quran? Kitab. Quran means recital, recitation, that which you recite. Kitab means book. Allah called it a book. What are they talking about? Thirdly, the Sahaba agreed. The Sahaba agreed. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لا تجتمعوا أمتي على ضلالة. My ummah will never agree upon misguidance. If the Sahaba agreed, then how are you going to say this is a bid'ah? How will you say this is a bid'ah? They say, okay, if anytime the whole Muslim ummah agrees on something, then it becomes a sunnah, then all our innovations are sunnah. We say no. First, the Sahaba agreed, not the people today. Second, I challenge you to find any bid'ah which all the Muslims agree on. Never. And we are the biggest evidence. We are sitting here today rejecting all these innovations. And with me, and we being the followers of the scholars of sunnah, are a lot. Never did we love the bid'ah or agree to it. So the ummah never agreed upon bid'ah. No excuse for them. No excuse. Fourthly, it couldn't have been done at the time of the Messenger of Allah. It could not have been done. Because the Quran was being revealed still. And some ayat were abrogating others. And the Quran was not yet complete. Once it was complete and he died alayhi salatu salam, now you can put it in a book. Otherwise they were writing it down. No excuse for them either, alhamdulillah. Fourth, they say cars, airplanes, schools, blah, blah, blah. Say, ya akhi, these are from the dunya, not the deen. The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not come to teach us how to be accountants, how to be teachers in school, how to be, you know, workers. He did not come to teach us labor work, professions, inventing things. He didn't. He came to teach us what? The deen. Cars, schools, whatever. These are all part of the dunya, part of the dunya. Some of them may be categorized under the deen when they serve an Islamic objective, which the ulama call it al-masalih al-mursala, meaning things which benefit the Muslims that hasn't had a particular ruling concerning them. Wal-wasail hukmu hukmu al-maqasid, that means have the ruling of the objective. Meaning if wearing atr, wearing tib, is it a sunnah to do it on Yawm al-Jum'ah? If you don't have any, it becomes a sunnah for you to buy some in order to apply the sunnah of putting on some. So these are things that lead to something Islamic. They're not acts of worship in and of themselves. They're not acts of worship in and of themselves. And the last evidence we can use to refute them is the famous hadith when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw some of the Sahaba using a particular way in growing palm trees and taking care of them, and he advised them. Then when they took his advice sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it did not produce as many fruits. Then he told them, "O Messenger of Allah, you told us and we acted." He said, "Antum a'lamu bi umuri dunyakum." You know best concerning the affairs of your dunya. That's an evidence that concerning the dunya, he had nothing to do with it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was a matter of the deen. How do you get extra dates in a palm tree? It's from the deen or the dunya? It's from the deen, it's business. And he tried to advise him according to his nasiha alayhi salatu wasalam. The dunya, it didn't produce as many fruits. So they told him, "O Messenger of Allah, this is what we have." He said, "You know your dunya better than myself." Subhanallah. So then it means the deen and the dunya are not the same. طيب. Let's say someone is still stubborn. Do you think we need to refer to the Sahaba to see how they understood these narrations in these ayat? We did. Let me give you in brief the story of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. It's in Sunan al-Darimi, the hadith of Yahya ibn Salama, and it's in others as well. Abu Mas'ud radiallahu anhu was at home. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari went to the house of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. He saw some of his students waiting outside. He said, "Is Ibn Mas'ud inside? Did he come out yet?" He said, "He has not come out yet." So when he came out, he said, "Ya Abu Abdurrahman," this was his kunya, "I have seen something in the masjid which I rejected internally. But I didn't see anything but good. I rejected it internally, but I saw nothing but good." He said, "What did you see?" He told him, "If you live long, you will see it." And he took him to the masjid. Now pay attention now. They went to the masjid. What did they find? They found some people sitting down in halaqat, circles, and they had pebbles, small rocks. And one was the leader of the halaqa. He would say to them, "Kabbiru mi'a," say Allahu Akbar 100 times. So they would all carry the pebbles and count. Does that remind you of something? The sabha, the bid'ah. Kabbiru mi'a, they will do 100, Allahu Akbar. Sabbihu mi'a, 100, subhanallah. Did Ibn Mas'ud say, "MashaAllah, majlis dhikr, a place of remembering Allah, let me sit with them, let me benefit from them"? He said, "What are you doing? Ma asra'a halakatukum ya ummatu Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." How quickly you have destroyed yourself, O ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Verily the clothes of the Messenger of Allah have not worn out yet, and his plates are not broken yet. Either you are better guided than the Messenger of Allah, or you are opening a door of misguidance. He said another narration, he said, Ana Ibn Mas'ud. I am Ibn Mas'ud. I am the Sahabi of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they said, "Oh Abu Abdurrahman, we only intended good. Oh, we have good intention, we just want to remember Allah." He said, "Kam min muridin lil khayri la yablughuh." How often does someone intend good, but he will never acquire it. He will never get it. So what does that tell you? Now these are the same people, by the way, who wind up fighting against the Muslims. These were the same Khawarij. They were sitting in the masjid, remembering Allah. How? In a manner according to the Sunnah, did the Messenger of Allah sit in the masjid with the Sahaba in a circle and say Allahu Akbar 100 times? No. Now even though the act of worship of ibadah, this is called bid'ah idafiyya, it's relevant. They try to add it to Islam based on another existing act of worship. Once they try to remember Allah in this manner, Ibn Mas'ud rejected that. He said, you will be destroyed. You are opening a door of misguidance. He did not like that. And Abu Musa radiallahu anhu had the same feeling. He said, I saw good, meaning they were remembering Allah, but I denied it in my heart. I rejected it in my heart. It wasn't good. Because they were in remembering Allah. Does that remind you of the Sufis? Does that remind you of these people? They do the same thing. Ibn Mas'ud didn't think it was okay. So we don't think it's okay. The Sahaba didn't think it was okay. We don't think it's okay. Even if you're remembering Allah, even if you are remembering Allah. Hey. Ibn Mas'ud said, radiallahu anhu, اتبعوا ولا تبتدعوا فقد كفيتم. Follow and do not invent. You have been given sufficient. You have been sufficed. He was teaching us, follow, don't invent. Hadhaif ibn al-Yaman said, do not do any act of worship which the Sahaba didn't do. Let's give it to you easy. Don't do anything the Sahaba didn't do. Ibn Umar said, كُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَ وَإِنْ رَآهَا النَّاسُ حَسَنًا. Allahu Akbar. Every innovation is misguidance, even if the people see it as good. So Allah gave him this. This is you know, Allah's blessings of the fiqh, the understanding of the Sahaba. For them to say something that we direly need today. We need this very bad. For someone to hear a Sahabi saying, every innovation is misguidance, even if the people perceive it as something good. This is their understanding. Don't be making no distinction. Good bid'ah, bad bid'ah. Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, إِيَّاكُمْ فَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمَا يُبْتَدَعْ فَإِنَّ مَبْتُدِعَ الضَّلَالَ. These are among the senior scholars of the Sahaba. He said, woe to you from that which is invented and innovated, because everything they have innovated is misguidance. So I warn the innovators. You see me? If you have been worshipping Allah, inshallah everyone here upon the sunnah. If you have been worshipping Allah in a manner not according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, listen to this. The hadith in Tirmidhi sahih. إن الله احتجز التوبة عن صاحب كل بدعة حتى يدع بدعته. Allah will not give him the ability to have tawbah. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah has restricted tawbah from every innovator until he abandons his innovation. You keep doing bid'ah and Allah will not give you tawbah. And if you die without tawbah, you know where you're going. Second, warning. لِيَحْمِلُوا أَوْزَارَهُمْ كَامِلًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَمِنْ أَوْزَارِ الَّذِينَ يُضِلُّونَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Every innovator will carry his sins and the sins of all those who follow them without knowledge on the Day of Judgment. Everyone who follows your bid'ah, Hamza Yusuf and the rest of the clan, everyone who among the Muslims who is fascinated with you and your innovations, all of them you will have to meet Allah Azza wa Jal with on the Day of Judgment. And what will you do? What will you do? Every innovator, what will you do? You'll be in trouble. Thirdly, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the hadith of the Hawd, his fount, where the righteous people upon the sunnah will drink from his hand, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, water, after which they will never be thirsty again, when some of the people of bid'ah will come, and the angels will prevent them. He will say, my companions, my ummah, they will say, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُ بَعْدَكَ. He says, you don't know what they invented into the deen after you. He will say, سُحْقًا سُحْقًا. May Allah destroy them. May Allah destroy them. On the Day of Judgment, the Messenger of Allah has nothing to do with you. You either act upon the sunnah or you are misguided. There's no third choice for anyone. Fourthly, they are cursed by Allah, the Malaika, and everyone. The Prophet ﷺ said, من أحدث فيها أي في المدينة أو آوى محدثا هو المبتدع فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. Whoever introduces anything in Medina speaking, or he provides protection, he gives shelter to an innovator, upon him is the curse of Allah, the angels, and all of mankind. The scholars agree that the mubtadi' does not have a shahada, no testimony. If he were to go to court and say, I saw this person kill that person, they'll say, get out of here, man. We don't hear from people from you. According to all the madahib, all the ulama, ijma', consensus, that the mubtadi', his shahada is worthless. What did he leave for himself? Allah has angels, the people curse him. He will be prevented from tawbah. He will carry the sins of everyone on the day of judgment. His testimony is rejected. What did he leave for himself, the mubtadi'? Why don't they follow the sunnah? Allah al-musta'an. Listen, we're almost done. Let me give you the criteria. Some may say, okay, akhi, I want to do that. I'm afraid of bid'ah now. You've done the job, inshallah. I don't ever want to do bid'ah. You scared me. I want to leave bid'ah. How do I know what's a sunnah, what's a bid'ah? Look, very easy. Everything the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did or approved or spoke about is a sunnah. Everything he left alone, which he could have done, is a bid'ah. Clear? Sheikh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah simplified it further. He said, for you to be truly following the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will not happen until you are in harmony, in agreement with the Sharia in 6 different ways. If you miss one of them, you're a mubtadi' by mistake. Sabab, cause, the reason of the act of worship. For example, people celebrate Rajab, the 27th of Rajab, Isra and Mi'raj, whatever, whatever. This now, there's no, the cause of this act of worship is not from the Sunnah, then this is a bid'ah. Second, al-jins, kind. If someone wanted to sacrifice a horse, can he? No, he cannot. In Eid al-Adha, can you sacrifice a horse? No, we have stipulation as what to. So the kind will make a difference whether it's from the sunnah or the bid'ah. Even though sacrificing for the sake of Allah is an act of worship, if the kind is not in harmony with the sunnah, you're doing a bid'ah. Thirdly, al-qadr, the quantity. The quantity, the amount. Can you pray Dhuhr 5 rak'at? Yeah, tell that to the mubtadi'. Say, you know, you're saying, you know, more dhikr of Allah. Hey, come on, man, 5 is good. 4 is, Allah deserves more than 5. Do 20. Pray Dhuhr 20. Why don't you pray Dhuhr 20? I mean, more. Say, look, if you're not, the amount, not with the sunnah, you're a mubtadi'. Even though you're worshipping Allah, even though you think you're getting closer to Allah, Allah will not accept it. Fourthly, kayfiyah, the manner. If somebody wants to do wudu, he says Bismillah, then he puts his foot in the sink. Can you do that? Then after you wash your feet, you clean your ears, and then after you don't want to do that. Even the sunnah, by the way, is so, the revelation is so precise as to keep you protected from diseases and bacteria. Imagine if you wash your feet before you goggle and put water in your mouth. That's not going to be very nice. But the way you clean yourself, by the way, is in such a fashion where everything is in harmony. So the kayfiyah, the manner. Fifthly, az-zaman. Can you, for example, sacrifice on the first day of Dhul Hijjah? No, you have to wait for the day of Nahr. So the time has to be in agreement with the sunnah. And lastly, al-makan, the place. You have to, for example, can you do i'tikaf at home? No. I'tikaf is in the masjid. These are the 6 ways. Every time you want to worship Allah, make sure that you are in harmony with the sunnah in these 6 kinds. If you have one of them missing, leave it alone. It is better for you to avoid doing something that you're not sure is a sunnah than doing it and being an innovator. It is better for you to leave it alone. So, in finality, let me give you a couple of ayat which should put an end to this. Allah says in the Quran, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. Follow what was sent down to you from your Lord, and do not follow other allies, other friends, other protectors besides Allah. Little do you remember. Follow what Allah revealed. Don't go anywhere else. فلا وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. Nay, by your Lord, they shall not believe until they make you a judge concerning everything they dispute about. Then they find no discomfort in their heart concerning what you judge, and they submit in full submission. Once you accept the sunnah blindly, then and only then you have iman. Once you want to put your mind into it, then you don't have perfect iman. Allah says in the Quran, ومن يعش عن ذكر الرحمن نقيد له شيطانا فهو له قرين وإنهم ليصدونهم عن السبيل ويحسبون أنهم مهتدون. Whosoever turns away from the remembrance of the most merciful, the Quran and the Sunnah, we will assign for him a devil and he will be his close companion. Then Allah says, وَإِنَّهُمْ, and verily, without a doubt, they will be misleading them from the path while they think that they are rightly guided. And this is the condition of every innovator today. He does not think he's wrong. He thinks he's dead right and you dead wrong. He thinks he's upon the sunnah and wallahi he's upon the bid'ah. But just as Allah said, when they turn away from the Quran and the sunnah and the understanding of the salaf, the consequence is that Allah will give him a shaitan, he will lead him astray and they think that they're going straight to Jannah. Subhanallah al-Azim. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whosoever opposes the messenger after the truth and the guidance has become clear and manifest and follows a path other than that of the believers, we will allow him to take that path, then we will make him enter Jahannam and what an evil abode. If you oppose the messenger after the sunnah became clear to you and you follow other than the way of the sahaba, who were the mu'mineen when this ayah was revealed? The sahaba. If you follow other their way, Allah will let you take that way, but Allah will take you to Jahannam eventually. And the ayat are many, but I don't want to take any longer. The idea, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the Muslim ummah is suffering a lot from innovators and innovations. And until we clean this deen up from these people and their practices, and our intent and hope from Allah is that the practices will be cleansed and the people will become among the sunnah. Now we don't want to lose any Muslim. We wish good for every Muslim. We hate the bid'ah, but we wish good for every Muslim, even if he's falling into bid'ah. We want him to leave the bid'ah, otherwise we wouldn't give him da'wah. But until we do so, the ummah will not be sound. The ummah will not be the honor. The reign of the Islamic ummah will not be acquired until we clean our deen and we raise the generation upon the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's an obligation on every one of us to learn the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah and to know what innovations are and to warn against them and to act as propagators against the bid'ah and for the sunnah. If every one of us played his role, then we can make a major difference in the community. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. Any questions?
I was in Malaysia a couple of years ago, and after every prayer, almost all prayers, there's a dua. What are you supposed to just walk out?
Walk out, baby. Out the door. See you later. Or deliberately, in their face, sit there and say, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Say the dhikr after salah, forget about these people. You advise the imam. And if you have the means to give a lecture and to advise him, stand up after salah, say, Ya Jama'at al Khair, Barakallah feekum, Wallahi, this is not from the sunnah. Then do so. But if you don't have the means, don't participate. Look, how many times did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lead the sahaba in salah? Allahu a'lam how many times. Not once, not even once, regardless of the occasion and the situation, he raised his hands after the salah and everyone raised their hands and they said a congregational dua with a ameen. Not even once. If Allah loved it, if that dua would be accepted by Allah, this is the right time for the dua, the Messenger of Allah would have done it or taught it or approved it. None of these happen, it's a bid'ah. Even if the biggest Mawlana in the world does it, and his turban is from here to Chinatown, it's still a bid'ah. And we don't do it. We advise the people, we don't do it. The sunnah is you remember Allah and you go home. Pray the sunnah at home. Aywa. Let me be clear, let me be honest. The beads, there's a difference of opinion among the ulama, just so you will know. Some of the ulama of sunnah say it's not a bid'ah. They say it's just a wasila. It's means for you to remember Allah. It's not an act of worship. But I read some very interesting statements of one of the mashayikh elaborating on this issue and actually deducing the ruling from this hadith we quoted of Ibn Mas'ud that really left me with the clear understanding that it's a bid'ah. Because it's the same thing. He said, what's the difference whether you have 100 pebbles that are in a bucket or you have them in a thread? He said, it's the same thing. Ibn Mas'ud didn't like it. He didn't approve it. He rejected it. It's a bid'ah. Al-anamil mustantaqa. Prophet said to one of his wives, remember Allah with your fingers, these fingers will speak, they will testify on the Day of Judgment. So the sunnah is that you count on your fingers, subhanallah, 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 subhanallah. Some say that like that. Some say like this, subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. It doesn't matter now. The scholars have differed on how to do it, but the fingers will testify. So the Prophet ﷺ used to count the tasbih on his fingers. He didn't use beads, even though they could have. We do the same thing.
What about holding a mushaf in Tarawih? I've seen people do it in Makkah.
The imam or the ma'moom?
The people who are standing behind. This is for better understanding and they can follow.
We've discussed in the lectures in Ramadan that this is not from the sunnah. For the ma'moom to carry the Quran, it negates the nature of the salah. Your job in the salah is to put your right hand on your left, on your chest, not below your waist. But that's another discussion. On your chest, and to listen to the imam. How are you going to open a Quran? Flip through the pages, you know, reading. An imam may cough. He may faint. Something may happen to him. What are you going to do? Continue reading? So now you have detached yourself from the imam. So a lot of movements. Then at the time of ruku, what do you do? Under your armpit? In your pocket? You come listen to the Quran. You love the Quran so much, mashallah. Or some people try to, you know, they're too lazy. You know, they say, okay, either Taraweeh or Risala in the Quran, why don't I do it together? So when they go home, they can just eat. And they no longer have to read the Quran. No, at the time of Taraweeh, pray Taraweeh. When you're done, read the Quran. Don't do them at the same time. Wallahu a'lam. Naam.
Is leading the new Muslim in saying Talbiyah bid'ah?
No. Whenever you are teaching someone something, then it is allowed for you to do it according to need though. So if you take a new Muslim to Umrah, and they don't know how to say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, you say, I'm going to say labbaik, you say after me until you have learned it. Once you have learned it, everyone says it on his own. Hey, Hasant, good question. Anyone else?
Yeah, when I was in India, I saw the same thing people are reading there. And I said them, this is bid'ah. So they said that we are Hanafi. So was this taught by Imam Abu Hanifa?
I believe if Imam Abu Hanif rahimahullah came across most of the Hanafis of today, he will beat him up. He will not be pleased the least bit. He made it clear. He said, it's haram for you to imitate me if you don't know what my dalil is. And many of the so-called Ahnaf today have nothing to do with Imam Abu Hanif rahimahullah. It's the later fuqaha of the Hanafi madhab from various countries with various Diobandi, Aqidah, Ash'ari Aqidah, and Maturidi, and all this was not of that of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, who understand a special fiqh now, and then they come up with all these bid'ah, and every time you sell them something, they say Hanafi, Hanafi. La, Habibi. Imam Abu Hanifa wasn't a mubtadi' like you. So that's not a valid excuse. That's not an excuse. Even if he taught that, let's assume that this was from his own statement, not the teachings of his madhab. Tell him, do you oppose the Messenger of Allah and follow Imam Abu Hanifa? Who's your Imam? The Messenger of Allah. So this is hawa. People of desire is very difficult to deal with. You should see what we suffer in the emails. Wallahi, ya Shaykh, I don't believe the emails. Wallahi, I don't believe. Can you imagine a Muslima says, do not quote Quran and Sunnah. Only give me logic and common sense. What am I going to say to this lady? A lady, this is a lady, supposedly. Don't quote Quran and Sunnah. You Wahhabis, you copy and paste, cut and paste the Quran and the Sunnah. You guys are play chess with the deen. Don't give me Quran and Sunnah, just give me logic. If I don't give you the Quran and Sunnah, what am I, a philosopher sitting here debating with another philosopher? And that's all I have is the Quran and Sunnah. Some Muslims are so wild, they have lost this basic concept. Everything is intellect, even though they have no intellect. I mean, if they were intelligent, we would say, nas musiba. You have no brain and you want to use your brain to understand the deen. Wallah, it doesn't work. So, ma'alesh, these are people of desires and intellect. You just be patient with them and give them da'wah, but this is incorrect what they told you.
If you tell your brother to tumble Allah
after prayers,
bid'ah. Like, how come in Taraweeh prayers, they make dua Allahumma taqabbal siyamana wa qiyamana wa ruku'ana wa sujudana?
Just say, طيب, I'll give you the same thing. Is saying Allahumma salli wa sallam ala bayin Muhammad good? Can you say it in the Fatiha? Can you say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Allahumma salli wa sallam ala bayin Muhammad, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim? Salah ala Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Good. Very good. Because remember the kayfiyya wal makan wal sabab. It has to be in agreement with the sunnah in these six ways. So now this one, the dua in the salah with the imam is one thing, and after the salah, then saying takabbalah is a whole other thing. The sahaba did not do that, so you did not do that. The sahaba said, oh Allah takabbal minna, so we do it. You know, the takabbal minna term is in the Quran and the sunnah, isn't it? In the Quran, takabbal minna in the sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ made that dua, so did the sahaba. So now the sunnah established that. Taqabbal Allah ba'd as-salah with the handshake is something that is not from the sunnah. We go back, Habibi. Listen to the lecture again when we're done. The niyyah is worthless if the action is a contrary to the sunnah. Everybody has good niyyah. Every mubtada, even a mushrik has a good niyyah. Even an atheist, his niyyah is, really there's no God. Say, but that's, you know, that niyyah is not going to get you anywhere.
One of the founders of Jamaat al-Tabligh, I don't remember the exact name of one of these guys. I think it was Muhammad Ilyas or something. He not authored, in fact, he compiled a book with verses from the Quran. Not just verses, in fact, some surahs, and even singling out some verses. And he named it Manzil. And it's very popular in so there's some people who do not even follow the Jamaat Tabligh. Even they are following this, they're reading this book. So they say that that. Because, you know, there were some, I don't know if there are any hadith saying that there are some verses that if you recite them in the time of distress, it will help you. So they said that if we collect them up in one book, so it's easy and it's convenient, so we should do that. So is this a bid'ah, like there's compiling a book with verses that they believe are will help them in time of distress?
Well, see, the whole point, the compiling in the book is not a problem. Every book of deen is basically a compilation of things that the scholar saw to be fit. But the question at hand here is, now the speaker's working, the question is, are these ayat, in fact, do they serve that purpose? Did the Messenger of Allah say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this ayah at the time of stress is suitable or beneficial? If so, and they compile them, alhamdulillah. If not, and they say, well, I think this ayah is good at this situation, like many people say, you know, if the woman is about to deliver, they say Surah Maryam. Recite Surah Maryam and Al-Inshiqaq. You know, because Maryam deals with delivering Jesus, and Inshiqaq has to do with the earth, you know, spitting out something so the baby is coming out. So they say, this is good. We say, look, Habibi. Yes, it's Surah Maryam and Surah Al-Inshiqaq, but it doesn't fit the criteria. Here, the Prophet ﷺ did not teach that these two surah will help you at the time of delivery, so you don't do them. So these ayat, they quoted this manzil, whatever they call it, if they're actually something that the Prophet ﷺ said are beneficial at such times, then alhamdulillah. If they're not, then no.
No, the problem is, what I want to know is it okay to compile them with only the verses? There's no information.
Yes, sheikh. Again, he's saying that this, he may, in the introduction maybe he said, these ayat are good at the time of stress. Tayyib, and he didn't say anything else. Now we have to look at these ayat. Are these ayat actually good at the time of stress according to the Messenger of Allah? If every ayah there is, no problem. If no, then no. Clear? Everyone got it? Sometimes I speak too fast, it's my fault. Yes, sir?
There's activities in the schools. Before they start in the activities, there's a plaque ceremony.
Uh-huh.
They allow to ask the people to stand up and the plaque ceremony started. There's two plaques, our plaque and the Psalm plaque. And we should stand.
Stand for the flag?
Yes, because there's national anthem. They song from the Saudi flag and the Philippine flag. But the end of the lyrics of our flag, we will die from our flag.
And the Filipino one?
Yes.
That reminds me of the Lebanese one.
This is the end of the lyrics from our flag.
Yes.
Some of the people from our, what we know, we are not standing.
Good. You've done well. Don't stand.
After the flag, they say remain standing because the flag is dead.
Yes, Sheikh.
Yes.
Tell them stand during the Fatiha, sit down during the national anthem. And see if they will do it. No, you know, many of these national anthems are you know, very good at shirk. All of them are based on your sacrifice for the watan, your death for your country, your everything is, you know, has nothing to do with the deen.
Yes.
So be careful of these nationalists, especially if you were, you know, from some other country and you become a Muslim or you're a Muslim. Be careful of venerating these national anthems. All of them have music, right? So I don't know what kind of, you know, stuff. It's singing. It's not a nasheed. They call the nasheed of the national anthem. I mean, it's rejected in every angle in Islam.
We stop our children to attend this national anthem.
Ahsant, you've done well.
It's better to not attend them.
And inshallah, Allah will bless them and give them something better in return. Allah will not, see, nothing will be wasted with Allah. These little things that we do, Allah will bless the children and their understanding and their adherence to the deen, inshallah, because of these little things that you are exerting.
Some people, they say, we are not respecting our flag. We say, we are respecting our flag, but we are not dying for you. But
no, even say, okay, I don't respect the flag. It's a created being. I respect Allah and His Messenger. You have a problem? Respect. Yeah, they want, everything should be respected. Not everything should be respected. There are some things that are disrespected if they go against the respect of the deen. That's just our perspective on things.
Which also goes back to patriotism. It's wrong, right? You know, being patriotic to your country, you know, of your religion.
Absolutely. Fighting in the rows of the disbelievers against the Muslims, that's a big no-no. And for having allegiance with your country, if it's against Muslims, all these are not allowed. This jahiliyyah, wataniyyah jahiliyyah, we don't have it in Islam. But Allah musta'an, Allah musta'an. The situation gets good sometimes and gets bad other times. And we try to, you know, keep the balance. I think this is enough for the night. Zakum Allah khairan. I hope everyone is willing to leave innovations for good. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika.